My name is Sarah. I use she and they pronouns, and we are here tonight for Center for Book Arts's 25th anniversary chapbook poetry reading and publications launch with a fabulous array of talented writers and artists who are going to share their work with us. Thank you all. You'll hear all their names over the course of the evening. Before we begin, I want to acknowledge that we are on the ancestral and unceded territory of the Lenape people here in New York City. And I wanted to hand things off to my colleague Fan Kong, who just joined Center for Book Arts' staff as our educational programs manager. And we are so thrilled to have her here. And she's going to say hello, and then we will officially begin. And thanks again, everyone.
Thanks, Sarah. My name is Fan. I go by she and her pronouns. And as Sarah mentioned, I am new here at Center for Book Arts and already, you know, am so excited to welcome you all to the 25th anniversary of the chapbook competition at Center for Book Arts. Okay. So now it is my pleasure and honor to welcome Simone White, who is our curator for this year's chapbook competition. Simone White is a poet, a literary critic, and assistant professor of English at the University of Pennsylvania. Her most recent book is called Or, On Being the Other Woman, from Duke University Press. Her poetry and prose have been featured in Art Forum, eFlux, Harper's Magazine, Bomb Magazine, Chicago Review, the New York Times Book Review, and Harriet the Blog. And her honors include a 2021 Creative Capital Award, a 2017 Whiting Award in Poetry, the Cave Canem Foundation Fellowships, and recognition as a New American Poet for the Poetry Society of America in 2013. She's a graduate of Wesleyan University and holds a JD from Harvard Law School, an MFA from the New School, and a PhD in English from CUNY Graduate Center. And she lives in Brooklyn. Welcome, Simone.
Hi. It's true that I have all those degrees, but they are not relevant today. I think the thing to do is to talk a little bit about how wonderful it is to be working with Center for Book Arts, which sometimes we forget how important the sort of integration of the physical book, the material book, and the poem can be, especially in the moment of everything being digitized. But it still remains incredibly important to me to be able to see poems printed, and it's such a joy to be able to get in your hand a broadside or a really beautiful handmade art book, which, you know, your words are inscribed on as marks. There's really nothing like it, and I'm really very happy to be here with these writers and artists today. I'm going to read very quickly, I think, from some new poems that, the chapbook has printed, the poem that the chapbook contains. But I just want to say also that because I've been writing mostly prose in the last year, I've sort of realized that these poems are all possibly unfinished, the new poems, and that's okay. So here we go. I'm going to read Open Letter, and I'm going to read another poem that's like hot on the press, just like literally in a Google Doc that I'm working on right now. Open Letter. This is for all y'all who say, this form of address cannot even reach me. If Simone were able to reach me using this form of address, it would be because it was allowed, which it is not. There is no known form of address for this thing you think you are doing with respect to me. take your breath in, you find yourself lost, stopped. In you, the spirit of vengeance stops itself. Ninth circle, you sweep your arms above your head, altering the current, but the currents know you not, foreigner to the current. The current belongs to the god of habitual funk, a tournament god who wears the silver bangle, stolen from you when you were 19. Upon those of inferior intelligence and superior guile. Whereas the cradle of address, going out, coming in, où il est possible de rencontrer, and what have you, every intention crests awaiting the widget proper to her vagina. Isn't this right? Ain't I correct? Hanging around or so-called haunting the area in which meeting would theoretically be possible, baby. There was technically an address implying notably those few dozen with whom I have technically had sex. And also remember y'all's names, the machine implications of talking with, the non-identical parts and complexities of men's. What terrors, what are the hours of your injuries? None of which swaggering in here too much authorize another set of movements throughout the pure day. Migrating warblers move this fourth month, only the young able to identify their colors against the color of the inferno. Brick dust and brownstone, hark, the female cardinal calls the baby, not you. A credible middle age ought to encroach upon the evenement et to trying to talk with a man. The first time y'all started talking about betrayal, it was totally impossible to understand the frame of reference within which such an event might take place. Who, when, what, the whole configuration baffling beyond recognition. Sense residing in the organization of attachment or desires, not some curiosity. Negated by irrational and figurative eruption, gestures of ghastliness, what my parlay therefore refused to be read, in fact, a type of curio that could be bought or refused totally. What kindness is among us, not the form of address of interest to y'all, is for spread, the language practice associated with gossip. Taking two fingers, touching them to the head, go down a 40 degree angle in measurement of the space between me and the interface, measuring the prospect. Its completeness is so small. One who works, such as myself, speaking to one who works also to the estrangement of our labor. On that repetitive note, it is not only y'all. One lives in a perpetual eruption of fractal jokes regarding breaks and shuffle and breakdowns. That was one of the jokes, but it's not even about what you believe it to be. The great love and theft is unparalleled, so that perhaps a certain kind of critique was thereafter unavailable. What they say, corrective. They can't hold me to that. What is funny to me is, in fact, y'all think I should be sad. What is your aesthetics? See, now we're about to have confusion because of changing address. The dance people have had it right for some time. The two-step questions are not a digression, but a discourse on hilarity. No, I am definitely not talking to you. One whole afternoon prayed away, baby. The time signature of Lola Bunny is ritually debased by refusal to write. So I must remember to ask you to count it out for me. Any entity listening to my grunted or begrudging requests, hello, not being able to get them out. More and more distracted by the inadequacy of natural endurance, pressure behind the one that doesn't progress, gets shrugged up. What's interesting about supernatural power, quickness leading to levitation or the ability to throw fire? Isn't that different from the erotic power, a relatively average character who flicks his body right might cast a terrible ego shadow across the vax room at Kings County with no gods or anybody watching. It's unclear who to feel trifling to, trifling being a relative moral performance of nasty indifference. Wait, it was to speak of the pursuit of a natural strength, to move myself in an unproductive crouch within it, unfolding, also spilling trash out the bundle of my force at the feet of a silly puppy. And this other poem doesn't have a title. And I've never read it before because I just started writing, so I don't really know how it's going. Black Dublin winged figment, not a figment, an angelic course drawn or spat upon uncooperation, maybe a very old curse, without believing in an occult of any kind, spittle or marks, having the quality of paper, film, besides transparency or rotting leaves, holes and filaments. I'm given to understand I am to work from the black double. Within her formally, I am to reconstruct her melodramatic hinge. Offended though I am by this terrible joke vagina, I'm gingerly to ask questions of this tissue, this ink blot. Fine, I'll do it, as if the commissioners will wait. This morning under the BQE, my son said slavery was S, slavery was st, slavery was in fact stupid, and stupid isn't profanity. His winsome genius modeling reconstruction for his stupid mother. Dully rotating this ink blot in her black and white undertow, dichromatism's a heavy weight to carry. Are we not rather before it? Its weight metaphorical in the way that is the opposite of illumination. This thing proves to be very quiet. I keep saying to it, what? Did I forget to mention that she moved? A fact introducing many problems. A gap is not a hinge. An open space introducing troubling magical conclusions. I would not say I was obsessed with mirrors, but then the closer my thinking comes to recognizable pictures, the more abjectly nonverbal the life situation or durational experiment is likely to get. This creaturely smear of barely black against a strong white background, don't be mad. Oh my God, I'm so tired. Also completely stunned by the weird rhythmic implications of John Berger's writing. T.J. Clark, they are both the same. Let me, no, seriously, let me. I put two passages side by side, one from Farewell to an Idea and another from the Picasso book. Inside, both of which led to lurch around in an ugly way, this whole situation, Kafkaesque, not only imaged as such at the level of the metaphorical protuberance, and at least additionally, the level of the required reading. Her lack of limbs indicate subjunctive demand to be released from the evolutionary or vestigial. I never bought any of that Fanon jive about how the white freak out when they see the nigger. I felt curious about the claim. White folks spit on my mother, etc. But I was born in 1972. Roe followed soon thereafter. My birth year and the year of the court's pivotal recognition of certain liberties or freedom interests, which are often confused. That's it. So at this point, I'm going to tell you a little bit about the greatness of works and why I chose these particular groups, these books. I think I'm going to tell you about Bianca's work especially. First of all, I want to reiterate that this is a blind contest. I know Bianca and I've known Bianca for a while, but this work is actually quite, I just wouldn't have known any, it came out of the many works that I read as a completely different Bianca, first of all. A Bianca who was working in a way that seemed to me to be particularly perfect for the chapbook, first of all, using a lot of figures, beautiful figures that seemed to sort of stay in space on the page as you read them, that really seemed to contain so much space and pause, that required their own small area. And so that's why this manuscript parallel bars kind of leapt out for me as the winning manuscript. I don't know if I'm supposed to do this right at this moment, but I'm going to do it anyway because I won't have another chance to say that Balik Bayan, which I hope I'm pronouncing correctly, had a similar quality of sort of self-containment. Of course, you'll hear a little bit more about this, but the box itself of which the poems speak, also a space of containment. But the thing about this work that really excited me was its humor. There's a kind of wonderful joy in these poems that I've been looking for a lot in poetry. And Dujie's poems really have that, and they made me smile. And when I was reading these works in, I guess, April or March, that was important. It was, you know, that was a time when we all really needed that. Poems for Bystanders, which is Benjamin's manuscript, was also really a standout because of its oddity, something really odd about these poems, and I love the idea of prolific poets because I'm not in any way prolific, and so the sort of manifestation of a person or a poet who would say that they were going to write 15,000 poems was immediately fascinating, and for me also because I don't really believe in anything anyone says, there was something wonderful about the possibility that this could all be an invention and therefore a kind of beautiful inversion of the possibility of realism in poetry that I thought was really worthwhile. And that's all I'm going to say. And at this point, I just want to introduce Bianca, who's going to read from her very beautiful manuscript.
Hi, wow. Hi, Simone. Thank you for that introduction. And hi, Fawn. And also, yeah, hi, Yuchen. I hope like what I read is like a fraction of as beautiful like as the book that you made was. Is. I haven't yet like held it in my hands, but I can't wait. Yeah, thank you, Simone, for that. I'm like in a space of unfolding, and I will try to read now. So I'm going to read from the manuscript Parallel Bars, and then some new stuff, a new like novella that I'm working on. That's the word that I'm using for it. But yeah. Okay. It starts with an epigraph from Maurice Blanchot. How tempting it would be to try to translate into a great revelatory affirmation those brief illuminations that open and close time, and that, well aware of their cost, she calls moments into being. Won't they wonderfully, once and for all, change our lives? Getting water. Mm. how young we were for all of that, like a specific kind of looking for a second without feeling disparate, to try and find the link between the specific and the generalized. What it is that we do differently is talk about ourselves. Last night after dinner, we discover that road is broken, but more where we are last night with her, where we're on a train, and with my dad and brother, and thinking about the stations, and it's always hard to get to them, or you have to get there at the exact right time. What else works like that? We ask her. We walk underground and there's this poorly lit pavilion, or we have little walking sticks, and it's like when we took the train to M, only in the dream it rained more. What you miss is beauty, we say to her, when it moves so quickly, and being attached, maybe that's it, to be attached instead of moving around it, feeling what it's like to feel things over a continuum instead of a sharp peak and valley. And not that it's formal, but instead feels like an invitation, because there is the creation of an expanse. We had Sanka set in R's old landlord's garden. Their neighbor gets evicted. To see among everything and to ask for a field while things lay underwater. Diegetic sound, non-diegetic sound, blood coming up from the floorboards, her fists against it, then steam from a mound, a cup and broken bread, then diegetic sound, non-diegetic sound, the box slightly open in a dream, slowly fading away into itself. Then all at once, everything combining. Within it, we, in our putting together projects, within movement and not outside, slowly becoming, and then its opposite, diegetic sound, non-diegetic sound. That night where it's very windy, the building swaying between the streets, fantasy becoming then an elementary fabrication with an elementary definition of price. Emotion is exchanged for the fabrication under whose constraint it is not exclusively maintained. Diegetic sound, non-diegetic sound. We begin from the perspective of objects in order to examine the struggle of the feelings against their inadequate form. In the everyday regime, then, the affects have been materially reconfigured into a mere demand for goods, which is a painful inversion of their very being. From the viewpoint of the wind outside, however, what we call pleasure cannot be treated as if it were simply the enjoyment of one good among others. It is only because it is related to a very particular object, henceforward a body, that the enjoyment of this spot of object can be considered as very hard rain, or where the shapes between the buildings are and where I find you in them. The bars then, at the entrance to an open box with the lights in the background, we, in our crossing back and forth, moving there, following as a circle instead of its opposite, coming out of the floor and again in keyholes or adjustments, losing sight of desire and then returning to the past, small openings or maneuvers like hissing or bubbles, we alone can glimpse their smile. By looking or at what, a need isn't final. A need at our pointing, or what has become invisible, what should be the labor, our deep aversion, invisible, for everything in frustration to come, in frustration, yes, in frustration, layered not as a result, but as a lock opening. At the same time, a progression towards it, but all around you. Healing is a miracle. Would it take or which instant is what's behind becomes the future, beholden her, and anger at its luxury. Yes, that's the same park, just to the other side of it. She said they would reckon, bound against outward acts. It's not that it's dumb, she said. It's appealing in a way you wouldn't understand. Now that you have imagined this space, stay longer than is accustomed. Now do this from your bed, if possible, until you feel a sense of it. Growing more now, and the veins reach upward somehow, beginning to towards coat to coat itself. She grows closer to where I am when I sleep, in the same room with opposite poles. Closer to the midpoint in the morning, we find a small field together and bury her there. The characters slowly complete their circle. She fucked so hard her hurt. In the drive-through lane, he calls me a queen. And everything else was in front of her. She could only hear English in the background. Everything else was in front of her, a miraculous pleasure. Then there's the ocean, and then what's on top, momentary and being happy, but also sad. What's on top because of the fucking, but also sad because of the fucking, momentary and being happy. Rich Street intersects with Best Street, and my negligence of nourishment. You reckon I take big steps. Delphine and Hippolyta fuck on the blue velour couch where nothing is transposed. Too many papers. I don't have a title for this either. Starting where she was in the garden, Vivi continued the round path forward, in between the roses, finding O there and resting with her a long time. Knowing the light came down from above, but rays not knocking into each other, instead reaching towards the petals themselves individually as a kind of inculcation to where they were, to mean an interaction. To start the recorder, she begins to rest, finding one of the many wooden banquettes surrounding the roses or surrounding the walls. A hand goes up and down the line of dress, thinking, who goes there? The chair lying surrounded by roses, and O begins also gesturing to the roses, opening up one by one, blossoms arriving when they did late in the night. Nerves connect more of a system of the soul than you wanted to admit at the time, I think. Not knowing where the beach ended, being blindfolded, for example, adding to it. Not because of a consequence, but adding as in next to it, where we were, by the rocks, and I was shaking to see if the nerves would realign, or not exactly, more to see what would happen to the transmigration of souls, like what had happened at the party last night, but harder to replicate on the beach, like I said. Vivi looks around, there was a small portion of the garden not filled with roses, and she had been sitting, not looking at O, or not having to, knowing that a progression would occur, knowing blood had something to do with nerves and with the roses, in a more general meaning, but trying not to get too ahead of it. Here was always a kind of dusk punctuated by lines of pink which surrounded the garden. All that can be seen beyond the circular wall, meaning above it, giving the idea of its being outside. Or they, the two of them, have been there from when they could not remember, meaning conversation could be heard through the roses. There was language, too, that did not come from O, and not from VV. Other kinds of transmissions. But this time she responds to O. The roses arrive only after the sun. There is sun here, that's something. But nerves cannot withstand it. I feel them cut apart. The process of putting them back or restoring them, as you say, would take weeks, or what I think of as weeks. Green tack on the side of them, he comes on those days, making putting them back impossible. Yes, he cannot come without the sun, O interrupts. Vivi does not respond to O. She also knows how to make tack come. O is easy. With her, it takes forever. Vivi leaves things there, outwardly at least. She is transported by the roses, or by O, or by tack, as Valerie, to her days in the Elektrika, a hotel on the coast, on the curve of the coast. Everything, even her past here, had a curve. Not jutting out, but giving the feeling of being drawn out, while still having the beach that it did in front. The waves, too, had a curve, as if they followed her placement, as it were, on the beach. But she realizes this only afterwards, a certain je ne sais quoi, but one that attracts, which made the entire system of tides possible. The pink sky shifts some of them and deposits her back into the garden abruptly, as in having to hold on to its limits. The walls, although curved, still retain a large S. She could not see an end. It was this in every instance she woke up. In the same corner of the bed, in its insistence to maneuver her among the rose garden, and here too she didn't have peace, as it were, not like she felt in the pink sky at the far end of the inexhaustible garden. Was it the house she ate that brought her here? The curse of its 12 rooms? Or was it 12 windows? She now remembered windows, having to close them. Taking care of a brother, which means protection too, knowing they were to be sacrificed. Vivi asked, could he be here too? She pushes her feet between the slats, holding up a golden butter rose. Only here its leaves felt red. She remembers feet pressing against the ceiling, the floor as it was covered in shells, spilling out from the shelves. She speaks to O, meaning back then, hold your body away from the windows. Will he come again tonight? Will we finally join them in same? Thank you.
Wow, that was incredibly beautiful. Thank you so much, Bianca. I still am like recovering. I feel like I have chills from listening to you read, and Simone, both really incredible, powerful readings. Thank you. I think Simone said it so well at the beginning. I don't think I'll quite be able to capture it as well, but Simone was talking about how important it is that this work, this written work, is in conversation with a physical printed object. And at CBA, we're incredibly lucky to have artists, very talented artists, who are in our extended community. And some of those artists designed the publications for this evening's program. But I also wanted to make sure we spent some time talking about the incredible chapbook that artist Yuchen Chang designed for Bianca Rae Messinger. Yuchen is a instructor at Center for Book Arts and a former artist in residence. She is based in New York and works in an interdisciplinary manner. Writing as weaving, drawing as translation, clothing as portable theater, commerce as everyday revolution. Yuchen was an artist in residence at Mass MoCA, Mad Museum, Offshore, Banana Fish Books and Textile Art Center. She has shown her works and performed at UCCA Dune, Taekwon, Abrams Art Center, Parasite, Salt Projects, and Assembly Room, among others. And Yuchen, I have to do this dance again where I find you in the list. Here you are. I'm going to spotlight you, and I'm so excited to hear more about your process and inspiration for the chapbook.
Hi, thank you. Can you hear me well? Okay. Hello from Beijing. It's 7:55 in the morning, and the light just filled my room as Bianca was reading before I was sitting in darkness. I have to first apologize and also say thank you for Center for Book Arts and Bianca and Liz's tolerance for my sudden traveling, which caused significant trouble and delay for the project. But it has been for me a great pleasure to take this project on the way. I made this mock-up a couple months ago in my apartment in Queens, New York. And I printed these samples when I was in Shanghai during my soft quarantine after my 14 days hard quarantine. And then when I was in Sanya for a show, I got a printed sample shipped to me and I made some changes there. And when I arrived in Beijing, I got the final print and I sold it with my mother's sewing kit here at home. And the first activity I did with my parents after not seeing them for 2 years was to go to a river and take documentary photos and videos of this book. And it was so much fun. It is a great pleasure to have a poem in my luggage. It makes me a different type of traveler. I've been to 3 hotels and multiple continents with this project. And it's still in process, but I'm happy to share with you where I am now. And I also want to mention that I really appreciate what Simone said about Bianca's work. I think that was the initial inspiration, the space, the pause it takes, which makes it quite surprising to hear you read it because you unfolded in time with such decisiveness. Because on paper, you can go anywhere you want with one word. But you know where next word is. But for me, it's all a puzzle and a package of possibilities. So I gave it much space. I think in the end, I realized my design is like a kite or a ladder. And then I realized the common characteristic of these two metaphors is the fact that for a kite, the design, the bamboo, the paper is really the facilitator for the air in between, for the space. For a ladder, it is the distance in between each two bars that makes it work. I also was inspired by the negative space that you utilize so beautifully in your poetry, and I want to create negative space in between the materials, which is my vocabularies that I use. Here, I'm really thrilled to show you a video made by me, my dad, my mom, and my little sister, which is a golden retriever. And I will share screen now. Can you see the video? Okay. Oh, sorry.
Tahat.
Thank you for watching. And thank you everyone again for the opportunity.
Thank you so much, Yuchen. That was wonderful to see that video. It was so evocative and atmospheric, I feel like, in the same way that Bianca's poetry made me feel. So I'm really excited that this collaboration happened, and such a beautiful chapbook came out of it. It is truly, truly beautiful. Thank you. So on to the next part of our program. We are going to hear from our runners up for the competition. And I am excited to introduce the first runner up, or they're both runners up, but the first runner up to speak this evening will be Dujie Tahat. And quickly, I will introduce them with their bio. Dujie Tahat is a poet living in Washington State. They are the author of The Here I Am, Oh My God, selected for a Poetry Society of America Chapbook Fellowship, and Salat, winner of the Tupelo Press Sunken Garden Chapbook Award. Along with Luther Hughes and Gabrielle Bates, they co-host the Poet Salon podcast. Welcome, Dujie. I'm so glad you are here to share your work with us.
Yeah, thank you so much for having me. Ahead of time, please excuse if you see little children running around. My 6 and 8-year-old are downstairs, hopefully doing their homework, but probably not. Thank you to the Center for Book Arts. Thank you to Simone. It blows my mind that you've heard of me or read my poems. I'm going to read two from the manuscript. I don't know if it's really, I don't know if it's gauche to say this, but the manuscript will be a book in the spring from New Michigan Press. And so I'm going to read two of those and then dig into some new stuff. Every Balak Bayan is in one way or another for my mother. Forgiveness is laborious that way. A never-ending line of empty boxes, so long we forget. I pin my awards to the fat bellies of stars. She pulls stitches from the spaces between. The thread is black, the point sharp. The odds are astronomical we'd end up here on the other side of our pale blue dot like this, at opposing ends of the cheap azure rug bought on clearance at Ross last week to cover up the fireplace burns of escaped embers. It's been at least a year. Finally dry enough to start, we throw in the kindling. Where there is smoke, I finally say, I love you. This other Balak Bayan poem is the one that Oswaldo, big thanks to Oswaldo, turned into a beautiful broadside. I'd never had my work, as an admirer of broadsides, I'd never had my work put into one. The actual thing that he came up with, which he will talk about more articulately than me, is just, it's beautiful. It's the coolest thing I could have possibly imagined. But the poem is called Balak Bayan in Praise of Impending Irreversible Ecological Disaster. Art making isn't suffering until it is. After a good day of writing, I don't enjoy it. The world is so strange until I remember I'm going to die. Then it's beautiful. Over a barren hill is a rainbow, a gesture towards artifice. The wasps that die for a fig to fruit in a poem I write are no metaphor. The planet is unbeauty. I've been divorced. Sure, my pops beat me. I failed my children and several other beloveds. The room spins. I am so afraid is a confession too. The world is, and men in uniforms would happily kill me depending on what side of the orchard I stay. I feel like that poem sort of launched me into a series of poems, the manuscript I'm currently working on, sort of about space, about place, sort of the place I grew up. And so there's some you know, this one and sort of the next set of things are for people who had to like Google their childhood memories and surprised to discover that what they remembered were in fact true or some version of it. After St. Paul's Cathedral burned down, Ma still drove us to Mass. Held in an old bingo hall, the liturgy came on folding chairs, kept time with the slapping sounds of small kid feet on a Duraflex floors. Of course, I did not know then, though should have guessed it. The old Gothic facade was quarried basalt from the Cowichi Canyon. On a different island, all my kasama's feet red. The whole barcada a muddy mess. Everyone knows a joke about fat lips and flat noses. As a matter of course, the lava flow followed us. The older Filipino woman in the portico are my aunties. When the firefighter broke into the smoking church, they found the altar already aflame. Too dangerous for Father Royce to retrieve the Eucharist, the 100-year-old domed ceiling caved in. A man searched for a shirt from the clothing bin, lighting his way with a match or a Bic he couldn't remember. So he was fined $4.4 million and spent 3 years in Idaho maximum security. Stacks of soot-slick stones were all that were left in the end. We knelt on hard ground. This next poem was called The Way as Promised Has Mile Markers to Guide Us. Pops bought a 78 Pontiac, a Firebird stamped gold bar on wheels spontaneously after a conversation with an aunt's friend, so it went. In this country, you can start a trip from any city heading in the direction of your destination, certain, reasonably, of arriving whole and needing to piss. A pit stop in Olive, California is a good joke, the way my dad put it. Hold it long enough and a song takes the mind off messing the leather up. Sunflower seeds in a big gulp cup, the most beautiful road in America. One sweeping hand steers, sun-drenched surfers slice mythology, the pavement swerves as planned, the lines blur late. No matter which window the ocean can be seen from, it's bedtime for all the birds with 100 or so miles to go. The gas man in Bend, Oregon asks how much, and before I unbuckle, I'm off to the races, knowing rarely do we stop at the dalles. Having forked in weed, we slope past valleys on the way to our valley in which non-citizens make the land profitable. My great-grands leased from the Yakima before the war. So much war has shaped what I know and don't know. The country roads lined with crates of stone fruit never return the interned, so a different kind of migrant ensued. Not knowing the dust carries on the golden hour, I trap grasshoppers in mason jars and walk away because I can. Yeah, some of those ideas I'm sort of trying on different poems, so bear the repetition. On Confession is the next one, and then I've got one more after that, and I'll be out of here. On Confession, subjects who accurately counted the passes in a basketball game were visibly annoyed upon learning they'd missed the gorilla suit, cartwheeling on the baseline, distracting from the difference between pre-verbal and post-language, branch, 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 branch. The tree red flares, a matter of lighting, slips through the before of what was said and the desire to never say it again, a vanishing, a returning to the land for the migrant begs the question, which, how, and why, for starters. What was mine the longest was stolen last week, a red Mizuno sports bag I've had since I was 5. I'm disappearing. My impulse to fade is a bat at night, dive bombing toward the red fruit of the garden nested in the orchards my great grandmother came to by marrying a man I never met who leased a plot from the Yakima Nation, not subject to state law barring land ownership by non-citizens. Filipino and Japanese immigrants cleared the sagebrush before being recruited for the war or interned. And knowing this, my desire remains to disappear. Still, my whole life I've been left to my devices. Here's I, loaded with God, ecstatic and erotic, pooled in a spoonful of light, seeming for the time it takes to finish, less vain, a bankless narcissus, responsible for a failed marriage, many crying kids, a beloved repeatedly elbowed out of sight, restored, and again, so here I have to say, I am not alone. Oh, I am not my father. And if I end up alone, it'll be for different reasons. Not even alone, his house brims as I turn the lock on my empty apartment, staying with my lover for the long weekend, looking at what I don't like, I call it an archive. And if my back hurts in the morning, it's because of how I slept. I took a really long break from writing poems. That makes it sound like it was a decision. I wasn't writing poems for a long time. And then I finally started writing poems again pretty recently after getting this sort of really big essay out of my head. And this is the most recent one. This is the hot off the press poem. Again, I feel like I said thank you to everyone, but I want to say thank you again for having me. It's been really, really great. I'm so glad to have been included in this. It's such a great honor. You know, I only wish that we were all together in a room. So the title of this poem is a long one. It's called On Devotion, or How It Came to Be That the Only Major American City Named After an Indigenous Person Whose Defining Characteristic Was Friendliness to Settlers Is Now the Seat of a County Named After a Civil Rights Leader Who Warned Against the Recruitment of His Memory in the Service of Empire. That's the title. The white folks do land acknowledgments in historically Black neighborhoods. The International District has always been Asian, but perhaps because Hispanics, insofar as these are coherent categories, moved in next door, it changed. So now both live where once was a Hooverville tent city mayored by a weird woman with a broom. In my neighborhood, I'm new to the turn of the till on this patch of earth. The morning plenary of baubles and the bamboo, the blue jay's flight path, omen, or portent. There are here smaller and fewer trees. So a different constellation of birds, small gods for which I do not yet know how to pray, what bone to pick or burn, flit. I have never had a yard in the city. If the line is a plow pulled one end to the other, readying dirt for seed, my sentences are the patch. The syntax of my garden makes no sense some seasons, as in what floats above shape them more than I would like to admit. Of course, there is what we say, and then there is devotion. For which, so hideously mortal, there is no depeopled substitute. Cannot self-serve at a corner store or be delivered by drone. Devotion is the till, the tool, the towel that stinks even after the wash. The air that breathes you knows all manners of lungs and furnaces and shivers in the leaves, the trees. The trees, equanimity weathers, feel so much like bravery in its interest in truth or what it is, as opposed to what it wants to be, as opposed to what I want it to be. Pain is not disorientation. Disorientation attends pain when we are not ready to deal with hurt, to believe we can withstand what comes next. On TikTok, I learned urban planners plant male trees because they make less of a mess, and because private property is inherently theft, and because misogyny, that's why my allergies suck. A history of displacement is basically invasion. But later I learned trees are in fact very queer. Most tree species have both male and female flowers. Either that or every flower has both pollen and ovaries. It is a gift to be in touch, to be with another asking, to be owing.
Thank you, Dujie. That was wonderful. Did you have another one for us?
That was it. Thank you.
Thank you so much. It's hard to speak after the poems because I feel them so emotionally. I need like a moment to breathe. Thank you so much, Dujie. That was a wonderful reading. I had only read the poem that was on the broadside that Oswaldo created for you. And so it was really, really great to hear so much more of your work. And I hope everyone else enjoyed it as much as I did. I'm sure they did. And so we are now going to hear from Benjamin Aleshire, who's the other runner up for the 25th anniversary competition. And I will introduce him with his bio. So here we go. Benjamin Aleshire grew up in rural working class Vermont. For many years, he made his living by composing poems for strangers on a manual typewriter in the streets of New Orleans, Paris, Havana, Barcelona, New York, San Francisco, and London. Ben has received a James Merrill Fellowship from the Vermont Studio Center, a Breadloaf Waiter Scholarship, a Goldwater Fellowship from NYU, and a creation grant from the Vermont Council. He serves as a contributing editor for Green Mountains Review and reviews books for 7 days. And we're so happy to have you here, Benjamin. One moment, let me spotlight you. There you go.
Thank you, Sarah, and thank you everyone so much. So exciting to be here, and I just moved to New York and everything, so to be participating in this with all of you is just like such a thrill. So I'll read some of these poems I've been writing for people for about the last 10 years. This is the first poem in the book that I wrote for, I didn't know at the time, but a journalist in Washington Square Park. I said, well, what do you want it to be about? And she said, doesn't matter, just make it short. Just a short poem, please. So you want a fragment of what might have been. Incomplete, there is no end to its becoming. In this way, we must be careful never to love each other utterly. But where is the fountain's eruption that you wanted? Where's the saxophone's frantic query? Where are the chalk manifestos melting with spring? Where is the... I don't know, 6 months later, I heard back from her. She had written this article about me in a German magazine that I could not read. And she said all these very nice things. Never know who you're talking to in the street, you know? Be kind to strangers, lest they be angels in disguise, right? That was written above the Shakespeare and Company when I was living inside that bookstore. What should I read here? This one is called El Océan. And there's sort of a long, strange story to this one that I guess I won't tell. Where is it here? This is funny. Usually I have like physical things and now I'm kind of like freaking out on my laptop a little bit. It's for a trilingual person, and she happens to speak the same three languages that I do. El Océan. Inside le caracol of tu oreille, escuchas les murmurations of los waves licking la arena. Quand you giras, le map tu traces avec tes bare footprints disparaisse comme les mots d'une lettre écrite con disappearing ink. Et maintenant, finally, apprendes-toi how to navigar como un sailor avec los new constellations formándose above toi, tu, you. I'll read the one that Allison has turned into this beautiful broadside tarot card that I'm so excited to see. I was kind of like texting people, can I go pick them up or something, you know? It's called, I'm like, Dujie, I'm a big fan of really long titles. So this one is numb with grief after my mother's sudden death. I write this poem about bottle gourds for a handsome farmer. My cork has come loose. Summer pours out from my unstoppered body, the months of slaked rain. It was my hunger that made me this heavy, too fat to move. I was greedy, but now I'll give you everything. Make your cups overflow until there's nothing left but the hollow space in the grass where you found me ripening. Maybe I'll read the very last one in the book. Or actually, there's a longer version of this book that I've been trying to publish as well. And it's punctuated with haikus. And some found poems as well. So this is one that I found. It's called Haiku by My Mother, Found Among the Marginalia in Her Checkbook After She Drank Herself to Death. Call Susan at bank. Ask about overdraft fees. cry this time. I'll read the last one in the book, and then I'll read kind of a newer one. If I can get Word to work here. I want to for some reason. It's called Elegiac Fields Avenue, which is sort of a play on words of the New Orleans street, Elysian Fields, which is the old, I guess, Greek concept of the afterlife and everything. Elegiac Fields Avenue. The end of the world is a bar, a bookshop, a brand of Quebecois beer, a strip of unsubsided Ninth Ward silt being licked away. We name our fear so the fear subsides. Someday, if there is still what we call day, archaeologists might interpret our word for coffee as dread, our daily cup of it. Mistranslation of our relics will be the only way to reckon our grief, all the street signs spelling out elegiac fields. But let's not speak of that. Poems aren't for reading, not anymore. They're what we use to twist into a fuse, a balm. As I was been kind of revising this book for the last few years, I got at one point really obsessed with the concept of the bystander effect, you know, which is this whole thing about, you know, you don't help someone because there's all these other people, whatever. So I wrote a poem called The Bystander Affect, which maybe will pop up. Oh, good. Bystander Affect, which is part of a collaboration I did with a visual artist. So it's based off of a photograph of this figure ascending a subway stair. Bystander Affect. The subway handrails take the square root of, I almost say, his body. And already I've said more about myself than I can of an other. What am I, a cop? Maybe it's the too long sleeves without hands, shoulders hunched for trudging. Or is the factorial of poverty, the poverty of our imaginations, multiplied against themselves? The stairs resemble so many equal signs stacked up one on top of another, as if equality goes on and on forever until it vanishes out of sight. That it diminishes as it goes is a trick of perspective. Everything depends on where you're standing. Take the bystander at the summit of the staircase, drenched in light from the surface world, texting obediently, backpack filled with laptop, gym clothes, ceramic water bottle, headphones I've seen in commercials, $280 in cash just because, vape pen, diploma, keys to the kingdom. That I can know even from this distance that his haircut costs more than my monthly EBT allotment also says more about me than it says about him. Every photograph is a mirror, duh, and a curation. Look, just around the corner, just outside the frame, beyond the boundary of tidy metaphor, the secret police is stuffing someone into a minivan. Just sort of angrily wrote the day after someone was stuffed into a minivan by the secret police in New York. Yeah, thank you so much. Maybe that's a strange note for me to end on, but maybe it's appropriate too. So thank you so much. Yeah.
Thank you, Benjamin. I think that it's so great to have you here in New York City, because I feel like your poetry is very much it feels like it belongs in an urban setting.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. It's definitely from from an urban setting for sure.
And I also love the practice you had of bringing a typewriter to the street. I used to work for a public art organization, and I think that there is something, sometimes you have to really open up art in a way that it kind of, people can't avoid it.
Yeah. like this strange service to I didn't want to read the like real bummer ones, but or they're not bummer, but there's nothing bummer about poetry, but like people come to me, you know, asking me why they shouldn't kill themselves tonight. And I have to tell them why not in a poem, or someone will tell me that they've just been raped and they want me to explain why it happened. And it's like so much pain for everyone involved there. But it's also like this like strange duty sort of,
Yeah. Wow, it's like a confessional and a therapist wrapped into one through a poem.
Yeah.
Well, thank you. And I want to make sure that we have time to talk about the artists who interpreted your work and Dujie's work into really incredible broadsides. This particular program, this chapbook reading competition, is the first one I've been in as an employee of CDA, and I'm just so impressed with all the writers and all the artists. So I'm just happy to be here. And here, let me, I'm gonna remove the spotlight, there we go. Let me first introduce artist Oswaldo Garcia, who is a CBA 2020-2021 book artist in residence. And Oswaldo designed the broadside for Dujie Tahat. And I'll introduce Oswaldo by reading part of his bio. Oswaldo Garcia is a photographer and art conservator who graduated from the Faculty of Fine Arts of the UAQ. He is the editor, printer, and co-founder of Gold Rain, a Mexican publisher of artist books, which won the Shannon Michael Kane Award, granted by Printed Matter and the Shannon Michael Kane Memorial Fund to outstanding emerging book artists and projects. With Gold Rain, he publishes artists' books, catalogs, fanzines, editorial accidents, and other experimental books in limited or spontaneous editions, mainly printed in risograph and always in close contact with authors and artists. And let me spotlight you, Oswaldo, if I can find you in the list. Sorry, one second. Here you are. Okay, there you go. Take it away.
Hi everyone. I'm on my cell phone. I'm gonna try to share some content. It says only the host can share in this meeting.
I can share some of the images you sent.
Great.
Finished broadside. So you should speak though, and give me a minute to get them all situated, and then I'll share my screen.
Yeah, sure. Well, it was, I'm very happy to have done this collaboration with Dujie. Many thanks, Dujie. It was a series of conversations that we had to do this work. Thanks a lot of emails and messages.
Oswaldo, I think you might be covering. If you, yeah, I'm worried that you might.
Let me see.
I can hear you much better now. Whatever you just shifted is worked great.
Okay. Like maybe. Sure. Great. Well, I'm very happy to have done this work with Dujie. We changed a lot of emails, messages. So it was like a real conversation and like a real collaboration. I sent him some of the first drafts for the work. And after the first meeting, we thought that we could go in a different direction. And that direction was gonna be the final box. So I'm also very happy because at the beginning, it was not clear if I could do the printing of the broadside because I was on a limited time on New York. But at the end, it resulted that I could print it. And I had like a real Bandar Tricks class with Ronnie, with instructor Ronnie Gross, that helped me a lot. I wanted to share some images, but I couldn't. But she gave me very real advice to make easier the position of the broadside, because it has like these little details on a different color that I discussed with Dujie, that it should have like how many colors it could have, and at the end we, with the help also of Ronnie, I could make it in two colors, but only like this detail of the red one. That was something that I thought that could be great. Also, the paper of the broadside is a craft paperback that gives more materiality to the broadside. And I don't know, I thought that it could be great, that it could be a do-it-yourself box, and go like think outside the box, and that it could be transformed into a different thing. So you could have it flat, or you have these instructions to just assemble the box and put it together as a different thing. And it's also very related to the poem, because for me it was like a bittersweet feeling, and I was thinking about my own practice, because it is about art making, but it's also about life, and well, life is like that sweet and sour flavor on it. So I don't know, I'm really happy with the result, and also to could print it by myself. And also the Balikbayang boxes was something that I didn't know about, and it is really interesting about the I think that I can read it now, but another important thing of the broadside is that it has like a little extract of text from Dujie that that tells us more about the Balikbayang boxes. After that, I also searched for more designs of them, and they have really interesting designs, and it also is something that we try to reflect on the design of the broadsides. I don't know, I think that's maybe it.
Thank you so much, Oswaldo. I'm sorry that we didn't get to see more of your process images, but I think the finished broadside is so impressive. I have never seen anything like it. And I have the little box, if you
great
scale, you can see this is the size of the box once you create it from the broadside print, which I also have here.
Yeah, it's like a playful thing. And I also love that it has like the texture of the letterpress on it, that is also on the little logos that's round, like the plane and everything.
Yeah, I think that it is a very tactile experience with this particular broadside, which is not even how I feel like you normally would approach a broadside. So I really love that is where your mind went and where you ended up going with this.
Thanks.
Yeah, and it's also so nice to see you on Zoom. I think so, if it's okay, I'll transition to our final speaker this evening. who is an extremely talented artist and also my colleague at Center for Book Arts, Allison Carter-Beaulé. Allison is a printmaker, poet, and teacher from Calgary, Alberta. She holds a BSc in biology with a double major in English literature from the University of British Columbia. She is currently pursuing an MFA in poetry at Columbia University, where she was awarded the inaugural Max Ritvo Poetry Fellowship. You can find her in New York at the foot of a letterpress or waiting for the L to take her to a letterpress. And Allison, let me spotlight you one moment.
Sure, thanks, Sarah. So thank you everyone for sticking around, and thank you so much to Simone for making these decisions and to my colleagues and to the poets. It's been really exciting. So when I was first approached by one of my coworkers with the idea of making a broadside, I immediately agreed, having not seen the manuscript, and I'm really glad that I did. I wound up meeting with Ben, and we discussed a number of ideas, just kind of brainstormed a bunch, but I waited a pretty long time. And I think I was kind of waiting for something to interrupt my thought on how to approach this. So I kept going back to the manuscript and rereading it and going out, finding new poems and finding new potential ways to address them. And the one interesting thing from that conversation that I kept going back to was that people were really bewildered. People are really bewildered when you write a poem for them. Like, it's almost like a goading joke. They're kind of like, okay, write a poem. And we talked about this a lot, kind of how suddenly they're just bewildered about the accuracy or poignancy about what he ends up writing, as if somehow he knows more than what they told him, as if the poet is this kind of divine and or divinatory figure. And I think that that's definitely exacerbated by the way that we talk about poetry as this mysterious configuration of language that operates somewhere between the planes of what is said and what is unsayable or what could mean. And I think one could make the argument that the poetic eye or the poetic eye is, it has to do a lot with how attention is allocated. So whether that's on the empty space or like how the sonics all play together or cat hair on someone's sleeve. So for instance, you know, someone might say to Ben in Washington Square Park, like, how did you know I have a cat? As if, you know, looking askance at him, as if he just divined that feline out of the page. But it's about attention. It's about what you pay attention to. And so I think going back over through Ben's manuscript and trying to find this interruption, try to find this element of divination, of randomness, of also of attention, I started thinking more about ritual practices and leaned all the way in there, thinking about like Christian hockey and taking a book of Georg Trakl's and shooting it at a distance of 10 feet with buckshot and making a poem with what remained from that. So I decided to just lean all the way in, and I got out Ben's manuscript and I got out my tarot cards and started trying to kind of find an interruption, find a connection there. And so the imagery of the broadside is based on the connotations and meanings associated with the Eight of Cups, which is a tarot pick card. And I consulted the Hermetic Tarot and the Smith-Waite Tarot and was looking at these things and thinking about the Order of the Golden Dawn and T.S. Eliot's and Yeats and how poets have been using things like this, using divinatory structures or ritualistic structures to evoke new meaning. And somewhere in the midst of all of that, I was watching an episode of The X-Files and saw this scene of Fox Mulder, Special Agent Fox Mulder, leaving a diner. And the image just really looked like the Eight of Cups to me. And the Eight of Cups, I should say, is this letting go. It's an abandoning or a failed of like disappointing venture. It's something incomplete. It's something left behind, unfinished. It's a gap. It's a secondary loss that comes from acknowledging that gap. And when it came to this poem, which is one that Ben read, "Numb with grief for my mother's sudden death, I write this poem about bottle gourds for a handsome farmer." And I felt, not only is there this reference to the cups, "I'll give you everything, make your cups overflow until there's nothing left." It felt, oh yeah, you've got it. I can also share an image that I have. Yeah, so there she is in all her very stiff card glory. And so the design really came from kind of this successive intervention, successive concatenation between Pamela Coleman Smith's design from 1909 and Ben's poetry and a bit of Edward Hopper. And, you know, one thing that came out there was that the architecture of a space, whether it's on like those cards or whether it's in a Hopper painting, the architectural perspective and mood seem to, they belie the interiority and the subjectivity of the people therein. And it occurs to me that much of divination and how we think about divination is observation, and the same is true of poetry. And so I think, I hope that Ben likes the card when he gets his hands on it. But this was a really fun project for me. And there she is, giant Eight of Cups, for anyone who wants the Lord of Abandoned Success to be gigantic and omnipresent, which I think, I mean, why not? Thank you so much. Wonderful.
Thank you so much, Allison. I loved hearing more about your process, and I was also lucky enough, as Allison's colleague, to hear a bit about the her thoughts going into creating this design. And I think it became so, it really, transcended even the original concept, Allison. I think it's really beautiful. And it's on this lovely, really heavy cardstock, as you mentioned. Absolutely gorgeous. And I just wanted to say thank you. Thank you to everyone who stayed with us through the evening's program. And thank you so much to all the writers and artists who were part of this year's chapbook competition. This was such a special space that was created, and so many fruitful collaborations that came out of it. Truly blew my mind. So I'm grateful. Thank you. If everyone, I'll unspotlight myself. If everyone wants to turn on their camera and say goodnight, please do so now.
Thanks, y'all.
Thank you, everyone.
Good night.
Thank you. Thank you all. Take care.
Good night.